journalists about your journey to work for the BBC?
You mean how I came to be a journalist?
Yeah, what made you pursue it?
Well, in school, at your age, I was very interested in news, and I was writing for the... We had a newspaper in school, a school newspaper, and I was writing for the school newspaper, and I was, later on, editor of the school newspaper. And then when I went to university, I studied languages, but I was still doing journalism, writing for the university newspaper. But I wanted to become a teacher, that was my plan. And I, at the end of my university days, I thought, could I become a journalist? Probably not, it's very competitive. I don't think I'd be good enough. That was my idea. I thought, I do love teaching, and I think teaching is a great job. So I thought I would do that, and I was in France teaching for a bit. But then I met someone by luck. This is a very good lesson for you all. A bit of luck in life is very important. I met someone who heard me broadcasting on a local radio station, because I was doing that in my spare time, and said, oh, you know, you should think about the training course for the BBC. Why don't you apply for it? There's lots of applicants for the just six places. Why don't you apply? You may not get the place, but if they see you, they might like you, they might give you a different kind of job. So I would never have applied if it wasn't for this person. And I applied, and I got one of the six places. And that's how I got into the BBC a long time ago. So it's a good lesson for you all. If you have a kind of dream, it's a good idea to hold on to it a bit, even if it doesn't work out at first. So for me, I wanted to be a journalist, but I didn't think I'd make it, because I didn't think I'd be good enough. But with a bit of luck and, you know, coming across somebody, I then got into the BBC, and I was, how old was I then? I was 24, 5. So I'd done a little bit of teaching, and then I joined the BBC, and I haven't left. I've been there ever since. So this is my 33rd year in the BBC. So a long, long time. So that's how I got here. Good question.
How being a journalist affect your family life every day?
How does being a journalist affect my family life every day? Quite a lot. So for the last 14 years, I've presented the news at 10 o'clock, which means that I get home at around midnight, mm-hmm. four nights a week. So my children have never seen me in the evening at all, you know, while they've been growing up. My youngest daughter is 14 now, so for her whole life, I've been doing this job. My eldest son is 21, so he's, you know, he's in a bit of a different category. There's two things I'd say, and this is a good lesson for you all in life. If you have a job which you love, which you like doing, that is a very lucky position to be in, and you must all look for things to do which you like doing. Don't slip into jobs because, you know, you've slipped into them. Maybe something that you're not loving. You'll have 30 years of work ahead of you. Do something that you like doing. It's very important for you to find something that you like doing. Probably last year when I interviewed President Obama. President Obama came to London last April. It was his last visit to the UK as president. And he did one interview. Just one interview, which was for the BBC, which I did with him. And I really love doing it. It's quite rare for a serving US president, as opposed to a former one, a serving US president, to give interviews to foreign broadcasters. So to get the interview was great, and I enjoyed meeting him. I picked my phone up because I got a good photo with him. And it was, you know, it was just a very, very pleasurable thing to do. I'm just thinking of this here, sorry.
What is the most important job? Lesson that your job has taught you?
Gosh, what a question. What's the most important lesson? Well, I'm going to give you an answer which is not to do with journalism, if I'm allowed. Yes? It's to do with working with people. This is a skill that you all need. A skill which I've had to develop, because when you all start off in your working life, you don't have these skills, or lots of them. And I certainly made plenty of mistakes along the way. It is to be able to work with people. People that sometimes you may not get along with. People who sometimes might annoy you a lot. People who might make a bad impression at first, but when you get to know them, they're actually very nice and very able. So the biggest lesson of my work has been to really try to get on with people who are part of your team.
What would you do if you forgot what you are doing to say, you are going to say in a news report?
Oh, do you mean in an interview or when I'm doing something else? What do you mean?
When you're doing the news, when you're speaking the news.
Okay. It's not an easy question, this, because for most of the time, you're really concentrating on what you're doing. And there are people talking to you all the time, yes? In that little thing in my ear, where's my bag? So I would be wearing one of these. Yeah? I'll be wearing one of these. I will clip it onto my collar. I will connect it to a cable. I'll put it into my ear. What do I find more relaxing?
Naps, I don't know how to say it.
Naps.
Or music.
Naps, you mean sleep?
Yeah.
I don't have any naps, actually. Do you think I'm that old? I have naps in the afternoon. Like some old grandpa in his chair. I'm slightly upset by that question. I'm dreadful at sleeping. I don't nap. In fact, I don't sleep very well at night either. I'm a bad sleeper. So I don't find that relaxing at all. I do listen to lots of music on Spotify. I love my Spotify. And I listen to quite a lot of, mix of music really, a bit of classical music, a bit of other stuff. And I do play the piano. So at home, to relax, I will read. I love reading. I love watching sort of series on Netflix and stuff. What I would call a box set, but it's just, it's online. I like watching sort of 5 or 6 episodes or something, which I give 3 or 4 hours watching. I quite like that experience. And I play piano as well. Advice to young people aspiring to work in journalism and media. Two bits of advice. At your age, to be interested in what's going on. To be interested in what's going on in the news, and to think about what your own interests are.
From London, and do you often visit your hometown?
So, how's my life in Wales different to London, and do I often visit my hometown? Well, I was in my hometown last weekend, so the answer is yes. I do often visit my hometown. Well, my life in Wales is really centred around my mother's home. So she lives in South Wales, is where I was brought up. And I probably visit once a month. I don't have a home there, but my mum does. Most of my life is spent in London, and has been for the last 30 years. And I live in South East London.
Most awkward moment on camera?
That is not a nice question. That is a question that is made to embarrass me. I know that, and the fact that you are smiling confirms that. I've had many awkward moments on camera, because if you're in this business for many years, you're going to have awkward moments on camera, yes? Some of which have not been my fault, can I say, and some of which have been my fault. In June this year, I had probably the worst technical meltdown that any news presenter has had for the last 20 years. We had a full system failure at 40 seconds to 10 o'clock. The new studio system is run by software. Yeah? a very advanced kit, which works brilliantly, but on this occasion, it went wrong. So at 40 seconds to 10 o'clock, we lost everything, except for one camera. So at 10 o'clock, I appear on BBC One, do my post, and I sat there in silence for 4.5 minutes. Now, 4.5 minutes may not sound a lot to you. 4.5 minutes is a lifetime. 15 seconds is a lifetime in broadcast news. 4.5 minutes is many hundreds of lifetimes. And I sat there not knowing whether I was on air or not, because there was such pandemonium going on in my ear. They didn't know what was going on. So I didn't know whether I was on people's screens at home or not. So I didn't know whether to speak or not. And if I was going to speak, what was I going to say? And how long would I have to speak for? How long was I going to be on air for if I was on air? Twitter, that of course, most people in the UK had seen it. I mean, millions of people have been sitting in their sitting rooms watching me sitting there in silence for 4.5 minutes, which is a very long time, thinking, what's going on? What a mess. What an embarrassment. I felt a bit of an idiot. So I came off at 10:30, and my wife rang, who's much brighter and sharper than me, and said, this is going to be a disaster. You look an absolute idiot. So what are you going to do about it? And I said, what do you mean, what am I going to do about it? She said, you've got to put something on Twitter. You've got to show that, you know, you're quite chilled about it. Yeah? You've got to do something funny, or this is going to be a complete, your career's over. Oh, thanks for that. Yeah. So I did have a brainwave. In my cupboard, somebody sent me some Welsh beer as a gift. Can of Welsh beer. 4 cans, actually. So I took the can out, put it on my desk, and I took a photo of it, and I said, it's quite simple. I just said, I'm going to neck this in one after that 10, you know, I need it. Yeah? That's all I did, just put that out. Anyway, 500,000 retweets of this. Yeah? I couldn't believe it. So everyone was now talking about the fact that I had beer on the desk. Yeah? This is a good social media lesson for you. Everyone was obsessed with the fact that this news presenter has beer in his desk, not the fact that we had a technical disaster on the telly, yeah? So my wife has something to be responsible for, the longest job I've done. So I'm a bit, you know, I'm quite interested in politics, obviously. What are the issues people should talk more about? I'm glad eventually that people are talking about things like, in far more serious terms, about the environment. I think people have been very slow to put pressure on politicians to make decisions about use of energy, clean fuels, getting more electric cars on the road, you know, all of that stuff. It's now become part of the mainstream, but for many years it was just kind of stuff that people thought, well, you know, don't have to worry about that. So I'm interested in those areas. I mentioned Brexit already because I think it's the biggest issue facing the country.
If the person you're interviewing refuses to answer the question you have asked.
Okay, so if they refuse to answer the question, you have to be very polite but persistent and ask it again and again and again, and maybe ask it in a different way. And you also have to signal to the viewer what's going on. You have to say, I'm sorry to come back to this, but you haven't really answered the question. Forgive me for coming back, but you didn't really answer the question that I asked.
Do you have pets?
I have a dog. Does that count? I have 2 cats. I'll show you my dog. My dog is quite a handsome creature. And I take him for walks twice a day if I'm at home. He's quite sweet, isn't he? Yeah. He's quite sweet. Yeah. You're not that impressed, are you? Yeah? Good. So I have a dog. He's called Mott. Okay? And I have 2 cats. 2 white cats. I like the cats, but they annoy me a lot. And they wake me up at night because they're always on the windowsill outside, yowling, wanting me to let them in, or my wife to let them in. So they're a bit annoying, the cats. The dog just sleeps all night, it's great. I like it, yes. Yeah. Books or movies, I don't have a preference, I like them all. And I'll tell you one thing I love, on the phone, I've got that Kindle app on the phone, so it means that I basically read quite a lot on the phone. you know, not buying sort of proper books. I read quite a lot of them, which I find quite useful on the tube or on the bus or something. I quite like that. I do love movies, but I love going to the cinema. I don't do it very often, but I love going to the cinema, and I quite like the experience of, you know, a film and a you know, a bit of popcorn or whatever. I quite like that. But my tastes in movies are not the same as my kids' taste. So they, you know, we have to compromise a bit. But very happy to read or watch a movie. Very happy. Good. Besides journalism, well, if it's done properly, there aren't any negative sides. If it's done badly, there are lots of negative sides. Because if journalism is done badly, you know, you're in the business of not giving people, we discussed it earlier, information that is reliable or trustworthy.